श्री कपिल सिब्बल जी।
सर, आई राइज टू पार्टिसिपेट इन दिस डिस्कशन, बट बिफोर आई प्रोसीड विद माय ऑब्जर्वेशंस, आई'd लाइक टू मेक अ स्टेटमेंट दैट आई हैव बीन अपीयरिंग इन मेनी ऑफ दीज केसेस, नॉट दैट आई हैव डीप इंटरेस्ट, एनी पर्सनल इंटरेस्ट इन एनी क्लाइंट, बट आई सर्टनली हैव रिप्रेजेंटेड सेवरल स्टेक होल्डर्स in litigations before the court as well as before the NCLT. So I wanted to disclose my interest. Now, sir, I think that this is a well-conceived legislation. The whole IBC code was the crying need of the hour. And we didn't have a resolution process in this country, a bankruptcy process in this country. And I think that I commend the government to have started that process way back in 2015, December. And brought this legislation sometimes in May 2016, and the process started sometimes in December 2016 formally. But this, sir, is a very complicated act. In fact, as the finance minister was saying, that we want to clarify several issues, and I think this is an amendment bill that seeks to clarify some of those issues. In fact, there have been, since its inception, about 27 amendments in this bill. It has been work in progress because as and when issues crop up, the government thinks of those issues and brings forward the amendments. But, sir, that I want to make a broad comment before I go into the amendments, and that is that our economy is going through some very difficult times. Our manufacturing sector is in the doldrums. In fact, just the other day, there was a report saying that Suzuki Maruti has had a revenue dip of about 16%. Tatas have a revenue dip. In fact, there are cars that are lined up that are not being sold. Two-wheelers, three-wheelers are not being sold. And there is no demand in the market. The steel industry is in difficult times. The home buyers, the real estate sector, is in very deep trouble. In fact, 20% of all the insolvencies are in the real estate sector itself. You have the FMCG sector, which is also in difficulty. And that's why the IMF has said that our growth in 2019-20 is going to be about 7%. And these are not good signs for the economy when you say that we are going to be a 5 trillion economy by the time we reach 2024. But be that as it may, sir, the worry that I have is that while you solve this problem, you're going to create a lot of unemployment in this country. And I tell you why that worry is there. So which are the sectors that have generate maximum employment in this country? Real estate is one of those sectors. Then you have, of course, the retail sector, the manufacturing sector, textile sector, leather sector. So all of these sectors are in great difficulty today, and most of the resolutions that are taking place or insolvencies that are taking place are in fact in these sectors. Remember, the backbone of the Indian economy is the MSME sector. That's the maximum employment sector for this country. Maximum people are employed in the MSME sector. Now, if you look at the insolvency proceedings, you will find that only 94 petitions have been resolved thus far. And of the there are 383 that have become insolvent. I'm talking of results as of today, and I've got the figures with me here. 94 approval for resolution plans. These are figures, Malas, that are official figures. And 378 have commencement of liquidation. That means out of every five petitions that are filed succeeds, four fail. In other words, four companies go into liquidation. Now, if four out of five companies go into liquidation, you can realize what impact it has on the employment sector. Because if these small companies go into liquidation, all the people who are employed will be unemployed. So you are on the one hand seeking to resolve these matters. On the other hand, you are creating huge unemployment issues. And there are in all about 14,000, I just want to state it before you, there are 14,000 applications that have been filed. And out of those 14,000, 1,858 have been admitted. So if there are 14,000 applications and most of them belong to these sectors, if they are all going to insolvency, the impact of this on employment will be mind-boggling. And that is why they say that the unemployment rate today is the highest in the last 48 years. And you're going to have more and more unemployment as we move forward. 42% of the cases filed are from the manufacturing sector, covering industries like steel, fast-moving consumer goods, chemical products, electrical machinery, basic metals. 20% are in the real estate sector. And the finance minister should tell us that there is no resolution plan in the real estate sector at all. Not a single person has come forward to say that I am a resolution applicant, I want to resolve this. The reason is very simple, sir. The reason is that in the real estate sector, when all these builders build these huge apartments, there is a conflict because they cannot deliver on time. Since they cannot deliver on time, the home buyers go to court. The Supreme Court has said that the home buyers are financial creditors. They have a role to play in the proceedings in the COC. They have a vote. They exercise their right of vote. And one of the amendments that's come forward is that if 50% of the home buyers authorize a particular person to vote, and that person votes, he represents the entire sector, this is a welcome suggestion. But the fact is, this is not going to resolve the issue. Because in the real estate sector, there are any number of group companies that build these towers. There is no resolution for group companies that we have so far. The government has not provided any solution for that. And I just want to point one fact out to you, that so that you just know what the figures are. As per the study published in a newspaper, as many as 220 projects launched in 2013 have 1.7 lakh homes that are stalled in 7 cities in this country, worth 1.77 lakh crores, of which the NCR itself has 1.18 lakh units worth 82,000 crores which are stalled. And there is no resolution process available under the IBC to resolve this issue. And there is not a single resolution applicant that has come forward. What will happen to this? And these are all group companies. Now, under the IBC, you can move against one company, but you can't move against group companies because there is no process to move against group companies. So the finance minister must tell us how you are going to resolve this particular issue of home buyers and how you are going to get the resolution applicants, because nobody wants to invest in the real estate sector anymore, because either the Supreme Court says you prosecute them or the Supreme Court says you give back the money, and we are happy. We are for the home buyers. They must get their investment back. But the fact of the matter is there must be a process through which is why the distinguished member said, why are you bringing this bill to be passed right now? These are very serious issues that could have been discussed in the select committee. We could have all applied our minds and decided as to how to move forward. And you know, this particular sector represents 1.20% of the entire GDP of this country. And for the last 3 years, this real estate sector projects have been stuck. And we are sitting here with closed eyes, not knowing what to do. And there is no solution in sight. And all these carry the risk of liquidation. And if these are liquidated, what's going to happen to employment? What's going to happen to the investment made by home buyers? What's going to happen to those who have invested? And remember, the cost of land, the maximum cost in real estate is the cost of land. Now, if you buy land at a heavy price and you don't get your approvals in time and you can't build in time, the home buyer comes after you, and rightly so. So the finance minister must tell us that by this amendment, which is an amendment under Section 25A, where you've added 3A, where you say that the representative of the home buyers will be entitled to vote on behalf of all the home buyers, how is it going to solve the problem? This amendment doesn't deal with the problem at all. This problem would have been solved had you agreed to refer this matter to the select committee. We don't know how these loans are going to be serviced. No, don't laugh, because there is a study group that is looking at group resolution. There is already a study group looking at group resolution, but that's not part of the solution here. Here you are only giving the right to the home buyers to represent themselves. And see, all this national wealth is stuck. These are half-finished projects, and we don't know how to finish them. So the home buyer issue, I think, is a very, very important issue. The other thing that you mentioned in your opening remarks was that you know, some big ticket items are being resolved. Actually, there are only 12 big ticket items, and of the 12 big ticket items, only six seem to have been resolved. And let me just give you the figures, because it'll give an idea to this House as to what is the amount that the secured creditors are getting back. Take, for example, Electro scheme. That has been resolved, and the realization of that resolution is only 40.38% of the amounts that were due to the secured creditors. 60% haircut. In other words, the secured creditors give a 60% haircut, and who buys it? A big multinational. Vedanta buys the same asset at 40% of the price, 42% of the price, and we'll get the same loan from the same bank who will finance this project. This is what is happening. I'll give you another example. Bhushan Steel, there the realization is 63%. Monnet Ispat, realization 26%. In other words, there's a haircut of the secured creditors of more than 70%. And who gets it? Consortium of JSW. So these people buy this asset at 30% of the value and get loan from the same bank to finance it. What kind of resolution is this? Then SR Steel, of course, that's not yet decided, that's matter pending in Supreme Court. Then Alok Industries, 17%, 83% haircut. In other words, the Reliance Industries will get this asset at 17% of its of the outstanding value. Can you imagine what you are doing? You are creating an oligopoly in this country. You are having a few players in this country because nobody has the capital to buy off these assets. The only entities that have the capital are the big players, and we know who the big players are. So those four or five big players are buying the precious silver of this country at a throwaway price. That is your great resolution process. Of course, this is better than the liquidation value. The liquidation value, it's twice as much as the liquidation value. So if it had gone into liquidation, certainly it would have got half the price. But this is no real resolution. There's another company called Jyoti Securities, which has gone for 50%. These are the six that have been resolved. There are six that are not yet resolved. And I don't know how much time that's going to take. So the point that I was making is this resolution is in favor of the big players who are getting the silver of this country at a throwaway price. The second point that I wish to make, and that's a point that I think through these amendments you are blaming the court for dilatory tactics. Because you say that if the NCLT does not decide on the default within 14 days, then the NCLT has to pass an order to say as to why he did not decide within 14 days. The minister knows that till now, many of these NCLTs were not even manned. There are only two people who are appointed there. They meet twice a week. So don't blame the judiciary. Don't blame the NCLT for the fact that you have yourself not appointed the appropriate number of people to deal with this issue. Now on the 25th of July, you have created more NCLTs and you are wanting to man. But you can't be blaming the judiciary that you must give a reason as to why you did not decide within 14 days. Then the other amendment that you have moved, that the total resolution cannot go beyond 330 days. Now, this is very strange to my mind. Because when you say it can't go beyond 330 days, you are saying that the court has no right to stay the matter. You are saying that the court has no right to pass an order. In fact, you say in your objects and reasons that if it is not done within 330 days, the company will go into liquidation. In other words, and the finance minister and distinguished members of this House know very well that 226 is part of the basic structure of this constitution. If you, through legislation, tell the court that you have no power under 226, and that if 330 days are over, the matter will go into liquidation, even though the matter is pending before you. That's not something that will be stand in a court of law. I can tell you that it will be struck down, which is why these kind of amendments that are moved without thinking about them, without sending to the standing committee or the select committee, this is going to be the result of that. So you can't bind the court, and you say that all those matters that are pending, which are beyond 270 days and... One second. Beyond 270 days, you are now saying that if those matters are not concluded, which are pending matters, in 90 more days, the company will go into liquidation. How can you say that? There are matters that are pending hearing in the Supreme Court. The last point I wish to make, which is a very disturbing point, and that is that you have, through Section 30, you have attempted to resolve a dispute which is pending in the judiciary through legislation. There is an appeal that is pending in the Supreme Court. I won't go into the merits of the matter. That appeal is to be heard on the 7th of this month. You have brought a legislation deciding the rights of parties while the matter is pending in Supreme Court. How can the legislation attempt to resolve a judicial dispute? That dispute will be decided by the court. How in this legislation, and you've given this legislation retrospective effect. I'm really surprised. You say this is deemed to be the law, right, when, since the code was passed in this House by Parliament. How can you say that? That this was always, it is always supposed to be the law? And how can you resolve disputes in which the government is directly interested? The nationalized banks are known to you. The nationalized banks are owned by you. The nationalized banks are to be benefited by this legislation. You decide for the nationalized banks, and you decide what they are going to get when the matter is pending in Supreme Court. I have never heard a government through legislation determining a judicial dispute which is pending in court in its own favor. In other words, in favor of the nationalized banks that it owns. This will not stand in a court of law. So while some of these amendments, of course, are salutary and the direction is right, but I don't think that these kind of legislations should be decided and bulldozed through Parliament without referring the matter to the Select Committee. Thank you very much.
Thank you.